Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
Well, God has a word for you today, and my message is entitled, Forgive, Let Go, and Live, and Let's Go Before the Throne of Grace, because there are going to be many miracles in here today. Are you ready for a miracle? Yeah. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you for being our God. Thank you for forgiving us. We love you today. And we thank you that you love us so much, you won't allow us to stay the same. So speak to us today. Give us a word, God. We need a word. We need a word from you. We don't need an opinion. We don't need statistics. We just need a word from you. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Our eyes are on you. Our expectation is that you're going to change us today. Thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I have written 16 books, and I think it's funny because I've never had classes really on how to write or anything, but it's amazing what God can do when you just decide that you're going to let him show his adequacy through you. I always say adequacy doesn't come from me, it flows through me. And so God is just looking for somebody that he can show himself strong in. How many of you say, God, let that be me? All righty. I just want you to know it's possible. And from our conference, we believe we inspired, motivated, and we believe there are going to be women who are going to rise. For the glory of the Lord is upon them to do so. Well, a few months ago, we all were in shock when we heard the story of 21-year-old Dylan Roof, who went into a Charleston church and gunned down 9 people. We couldn't believe that. But then a few days later, at his bond hearing, we heard the family speak to him, and they said, "We forgive you." Now, I have to tell you, that was particularly moving for me because I grew up in a family, let's just say I'd inherited a legacy of unforgiveness. I mean, we really didn't forgive anybody, and I have family members today who can validate that. My mother and my father argued all the time. It was always about something in the past, something in the far, far past. And, you know, and I thought, man, did they ever resolve any issues? And it was a circular argument. They would just keep coming around to the same thing. I think that's why I teach communications today, because it's like, settle that. You know, land that plane and go into something else. But I was so entrenched in unforgiveness. And I told my husband when we were first married, and we've been married 36 years, did I acknowledge you? That's my man. Darnell, stand up. I was trying to save him for last and left him off. See, that's what happens when you're old. Okay. But I told my husband, I said, listen now, try not to do anything that I have to forgive you for, because in our family, we don't do any forgiving. We do no forgiving, okay? So just try to be real good if you can, because it takes me a long time to get over stuff. So, you know, do your best not to do anything where I have to forgive you. And it sounds funny now, but I meant it. And but God sent me a great mentor, and she modeled forgiveness. She taught the scriptures on forgiveness, and she always would say, we all hurt people. She said, but we need to learn how to release everybody. And that became kind of the motto for my life, that I release everybody. Now, I'm just now coming into this. It's amazing how when you write a book about something, you really learn it. And so it has only been in the last few years, and Darnell can tell you, that I've really began to release people. And I can say this morning, there's nobody in my life that I feel like I need to forgive. Notwithstanding, a few weeks ago, a lady did accuse me of something that was just totally wrong. And she said I had embellished some truth so I could sell some books. I was so mad at that lady, I went to whack her with the book, but I didn't. I just say, Lord, I forgive. But when I looked at those families who told Dylan that they forgive him, I said, where do you get that kind of power to release that kind of forgiveness to somebody? And what is forgiveness anyway? What does that mean exactly? Does that mean we don't seek justice if you forgive somebody? I just want to give you a definition up front, and I'll give it again and again throughout the message. But forgiveness is simply giving up the right to pay back, giving up the right to avenge the wrong that somebody has perpetrated against you. And when you think about that, that's all it is. I just release you from further debt. Because it's very hard for Christians to forgive, too. And it amazes me that it is so hard, because we of all people should understand forgiveness more than anybody else. You know why? Because we have been forgiven. We have been forgiven. See, the problem is when somebody hurts us or just does something bad to us or whatever, causes us any kind of pain, it creates a debt in our mind. You owe me something. And, you know, and oftentimes when you're trying to work through forgiveness, you got to ask yourself, what does that person owe me? What do I want? What do I want from that person? You see, many times a person has done something and the debt can't be repaid. They may have killed a relative. They may have smeared your reputation or whatever, but they can't repay the debt. And that's why you have to release the debt. Now, we understand that because all of us have sinned and Jesus came and paid it all. He paid it all. God is not holding us responsible for anything we've done that we've repented for. Isn't that a great truth? I mean, that's enough to rejoice about right there, isn't it? That's enough to rejoice about right there. And so many times, though, I know for me, I struggled with forgiveness because I knew I was supposed to leave payback to God and all that. But I also know God is merciful. And I thought, if I just leave it to God, they may not suffer any pain. I need people who hurt me to suffer some pain, too. But that's not what God wants you to know this morning. So there are some truths that I believe we're going to have to embrace, and I want to share a few with you. The first one I want to tell you to embrace is the fact that if we don't forgive others, God is not going to forgive us. Now, I know some of us don't believe that, and we can just go our merry way and we say, we do something, we say, Lord, forgive me, and then somebody does something to us, and we try to hold it against them forever. But let's turn to the scriptures and see what God has to say about that. In Mark 11, it talks about how we have the power to ask God for anything. And we all love Mark 11, 23 and 24. If thou shalt say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be casted into the sea, and don't doubt, we'll have whatever we say. We like that, don't we? How many of you like that scripture? Whatever we believe in prayer, asking for it, when believing, we'll get it. And then here comes Mark 11, 25. And it's like a giant eraser. It says, and whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anybody, forgive him. Say that with me. Anything against anyone, forgive him. Why? Why do we have to do that? That your Father in heaven may also forgive you. And then in verse 26 it says, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you your trespasses. In case you missed the point in verse 25, he wants to reiterate. Now you got to watch some of these new translations of the Bible, because I was noticing some of them leave that scripture out. They leave out Mark 26. You won't find it. You won't find it. And it says, I guess they want us to just pretend it's not there, but this is the truth, people. And these are the words of Jesus. It's written in red in the Bible. These are Jesus' words. He says, if you don't forgive somebody, I'm not going to forgive you. Imagine what it would feel like to live in a world where you can't be forgiven. But imagine that you are the one who sets the tone. You determine the criteria by which God's going to forgive you, because the minute you release somebody, God says, I'll release you. But if you don't, I'm not going to release you. And you know what's interesting? When Job was suffering so, the Bible says that God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for those friends who had come to comfort him, but they weren't a comfort. And I'm sure he was sitting there vexed to no end with them telling him it's all his fault that he was suffering, when we all knew it was the devil. But the Bible says that God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. It's amazing the breakthrough some of you are going to get when you leave this service, because you're going to decide that you are going to forgive people. And let me just not make an assumption. How many of you need to be forgiven? Okay, I just want to make sure. All right. Well, since God only forgives those who forgive others, then I just want to make sure that you understand the position that you are in. It's so important that we become a channel of mercy and a channel of forgiveness. I'm asking God for that in my own life, because I'm always like, I'm done with that person. You know, I kind of alienate them. You know, now sometimes I don't say it, because I know that's not the Christian thing to do, is to alienate people. So I alienate them without telling them. You know, somebody used to do something to me, I was just like, you know, I'm just too busy to be with that person anymore. You know what that's called? Playing God, when you banish people from your presence. And if you ever banish somebody from your presence, you just don't tell them that. You just don't be with them anymore. You know, you have all kind of excuses. Oh, I got something to do. And, you know, I found that, because the Lord showed me that I use that excuse as being busy to alienate a lot of people. I ain't that busy. But everybody said, oh, we know you're so busy. Like, I am not that busy, okay? I mean, I'm busy, but I'm not that busy. But I realized, though, you know, come on, tell the truth. David said God desires truth in the inward parts. And so I try not to let myself buy with stuff. And I said to myself, you are not that busy for that person. You know, how come you can say yes to that one, but you can't say yes to that one? Like, because I don't like that one, you know? But that's not God's way. You got to be truthful, amen? All right, truth number two, and this one is even harder to swallow. God has foreknowledge of every deed done against you. God has foreknowledge of everything the enemy has ever done before you, towards you. He could have stopped it. Let that sink in. He knew about it. He could have stopped it, but he allowed it to be so. That's why some people don't like God today. They mad at God. You could have stopped that. You know, and I've seen things in my life, and I'm thinking like, no, you could have stopped that. But he chose not to because God has a greater good. God has a greater good. Say that with me. God has a greater good. Say, my pain has purpose. You know, so as we watched that story of Dylan Roof unfold, and he talked about how he really wanted to start a race war, and that's why he killed those people in that church. But you see, the opposite happened. He didn't start a race war. People came together. Blacks and whites came together. And all of a sudden, now we don't have that Confederate flag flying down there. You see, so God had a higher good, and God has a higher good. Even though he doesn't initiate it, he can use what the enemy tries to put together. And that's why I like Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good for those who love God. You got to believe that. You got to say that about yourself. You got to personalize that scripture. And I know that all things work together for my good because I love God and I am called according to his purpose. No matter what's going on, sometimes I'll just look up and say, I know you got a purpose in this, and I got to learn to trust your divine prerogative. God has divine prerogative. Say that big word with me. Divine prerogative. Let's talk about what we can do. How do we work through this? I really want this to be very practical this morning. In the first service afterwards, I was out there signing books, and a gentleman came up to me, and he said God just revealed to him some things while I was speaking to let him know that that's why his breakthrough hadn't happened, because he was blocking it with his unforgiveness. And I believe that's going to happen here this morning. That's going to happen here this morning. So let me just give you a couple of things, a couple of myths. A lot of times we have an idea in our heads as to what forgiveness is, and that's not it at all. So let me just talk about number one. First myth is that we have to forgive and forget. How many of you have heard that? Forgive and forget. You can't forget. Only God can forget stuff. You can't obliterate something from your memory. You've been on the computer too long. You can't press delete. It's in your memory. It's in your memory, and you can't change it. But let me tell you, you can choose how you remember. You can decide that you don't have to remember with malice and with an intention to want to get somebody back or wish them harm. You can decide you don't want to remember like that. You got to remember that something happened, but it's all working together for your good. It'll be like a scar. I've had 7 surgeries. I have been cut from head to toe. I've had brain surgery. I've had foot surgery and stuff in between. And I'm still here. And I'm the better because of it. I'm the better because of it. I'm the better because of it. Yes, I got scars. I got scars, all right? But it's all right because I am better. And I don't look at those scars and go, that shouldn't have happened. Well, it happened and it's made me who I am. And so that's why we got to learn how to remember, but we got to remember God's way, all right? Let me give you another myth that really keeps us from forgiving people or thinking that we have not forgiven people. Is that we have to be restored to that relationship. The relationship has to be restored to its condition. That's not true. Sometimes you don't need to restore a relationship. So I'm going to give you 3 options. I'm going to give you 3 options. When somebody has hurt you, somebody has offended you, somebody has disadvantaged you in any way, you got 3 options. First of all, you can restore the relationship. You can do that if God is telling you to do that. He wants us to forgive everybody. See, that's a given. But you don't always have to come back and go back into that same relationship. In fact, I got a little cute story I want to tell you. There's this man who went to the doctor because he had a severe burn on his right side of his face. And the doctor said, how did you get that? He said, well, I was ironing and the telephone rang and I picked up the iron, burned my face. And the doctor said, wow, well, how'd you get the one on this side? He said, he called back. Now, you don't have to be stupid twice. That's not in the Bible. You don't have to be stupid twice. But if a person has shown genuine repentance, then you need to restore, that person. That person needs to be restored. You hear me? And even if they don't show repentance, you got to forgive them. We're talking about how do you move forward in the relationship after you have forgiven. Are you understanding this? That doesn't mean you don't forgive. I'm talking about how you move forward in a relationship after you have forgiven, after you have given up the desire for payback. This is how you move forward. Number 2, you can redefine the relationship. You can just say, you know what, I'm not going to restore that relationship because this person is too toxic or whatever, but I'm just going to redefine how I go forward. We don't have to be intimate friends anymore. And you don't have to tell them, by the way. I am not going to be your intimate friend anymore. You don't have to tell them that. All right? But one of the best examples of someone who redefined a relationship is found in Judges 11. I really want you to read this when you go home. The story is too long for me to read it, but it's one of my favorite stories. Because it's a story of a young man whose mother was a harlot, and he grew up in the house with his father's other legitimate kids, and they kicked him out. They said, "You will not have an inheritance in our father's house. You get out." And so he got out, and he went and became a mighty warrior. And in the course of time, a great enemy came against these people, the children of Gilead, and they needed somebody to lead them in war, but they didn't have the ability to do it. But guess who had the ability to do it? Jephthah. And the Bible says they came to him and said, "Listen, we need you to go to war with us." And I like what Jephthah did, because he didn't try to sweep it under the rug and say, "Oh, well, okay, I'm just glad to be embraced by you now, because I'm so unworthy. You can abuse me and kick me out, and that's fine. I'm glad to be with you." He didn't say that. He said, "Wait a minute. Didn't you hate me and cast me out?" That's Judges 11:7. I'm in the book. "Didn't you hate me and cast me out? Why are you coming to me now when you are in trouble?" And they said something that always surprises me. They said, "So you can help us." Duh. "So you can help us," because the other version of the Bible says, "'cause we need you." You see, people will do that to you. And if you don't have any self-esteem, or you don't perceive that your merchandise is good, which we learned in the conference what that means, if you don't know what you bring to the table, people will dishonor you in all kinds of ways. You don't have to let them do that. That's not in the Bible that you have to let them do that. Some of us think if we take abuse, that just makes us more godly. That just makes you more stupid. I had a friend who had a very abusive husband. Well, she was a friend. She was a distant relative. And they had come to L.A., and she was telling me about it. And she said, "And he used to beat me all the time." And she said, and I would say, "No matter how much you beat me, Jesus loves you, and I forgive you." I'm like, "Really?" I'm like, "Whoa, if that's God, he sure knows who to give that assignment to." I'm thinking, well, could I have done that? I don't think God calls people to do that, but I wonder, could I have done that? I'm thinking, I'm reliving this story. "Jesus loves you." I could have said that part. And I'm thinking, like, okay, Jesus loves you. I'm thinking what I would have said. "Jesus loves you, and I'm about to give you a one-way ticket to meet him tonight." Just kidding. No killing husbands. But there are some people who have this myth in their heads, and it causes them to stay in abuse. God's not calling you to be stupid twice. He's not calling you to stay in an abusive situation. In fact, during our conference, we had a special altar call for people who were in abusive situations that God would cause them to get out of. And was that awesome, Pastor Jess? Women came down from all around, and they left here empowered. I know they did. I know they did. Well, the third option is that you can release the relationship. That means you let it go. It's too toxic. This person doesn't mean you any good. They don't care about your goals, your ambitions. It's all about them. You got to always pay for the meal. You got to cater to them. God's not calling you to be in that kind of relationship. Can I just say that? That is ungodly. That is just not God. And let me tell you, this person may be somebody in your family. They could be toxic. So I want to tell you this. I don't believe in disconnecting from family members. Our family went through a tough time after my father died. And there was a lot of turmoil because my dad had put me over the will. And I'm a CPA by training. So I did everything by the book, made everybody crazy, you know, because it's like it has to be by the book because I'm the executor. So I don't regret what I did. But it made everybody a little crazy for a minute. I understood that. But I was mad at him. And seeing if I hadn't learned how to forgive, and I had said, because this had been my attitude, and I know it's a defense mechanism, all of you who try to play like you so tough. It's like, if you don't like me, I don't like you. So if y'all don't want to talk to me, I don't want to talk to y'all neither. But God said, that's not what I called you to do. You're the one filled with the Holy Spirit. So you got to be the peacemaker. Blessed are the peacemakers, those who actively seek to make peace. He said, that's your calling. You be the peacemaker. And today, our family is stronger than it's been in a long, long, long time. And I'm so glad about that, because that's the work of the Lord. Amen. But sometimes with some people, when you don't have those necessary relationships, they are toxic people. And you got to treat them like you do easy off that stuff you clean your stove with. You know what I mean by that? How many of you, any of y'all ever clean your stove? Okay. Well, Easy Off is the stuff you can spray on it when your husband has made a steak and it gets all the stuff on the grill. So I had somebody who was cleaning my stove one day, and I said, listen, you're going to need to put some Easy-Off on that. I know about cleaning. I was a maid at 75 cents an hour way back in the day. So I know how to clean. I said, you're going to need to use some Easy-Off on that. And she says, no, I don't want to use the Easy-Off. She said, it stinks. It makes you sick. I'm like, no, I got to teach you how to use Easy-Off. You don't stand there and inhale it. You know, you spray that stuff and you run away and let it do its job and you come back later. So I said, that's how you got to treat relatives who are, you know, toxic. You know, if they always mad and angry and put you down, you know, you don't want to totally disconnect from them because you really want to be the force of Jesus in their lives. And so you just call them for a quick visit. You say, hello, how you doing? This is Deborah. I'm just calling to see how you're doing. Okay, well, listen, God bless you. I'm praying for you. Bye. Now, why are you going to stay on the phone with an hour with somebody telling you how awful you are? That's just smelling the Easy-Off, okay? That was a freebie. I'm not charging for that one. When you get ready to forgive somebody, it's really a series of decisions that you make. And I want to just walk you through a few decisions you got to make. I'll put several in the book, but I want to tell you just about a couple of decisions that you have to make when you decide you're going to walk this road to forgiveness. First of all, I want you to understand that forgiveness is supernatural. You can't try this in your own strength. It is not natural to forgive. It is not your natural inclination to forgive somebody. You want somebody to pay. So understand that. You can't count to 10. You can't make a New Year's resolution. You got to say, Holy Ghost, help me. Father, I receive your power to forgive. I receive your love. It is a fruit of the Spirit. It is a fruit of the Spirit. Say that with me. It is a fruit of the Spirit. That means the Spirit has produced that ability in me to forgive. But I got to ask him to do it. Because sometimes the weight of forgiveness is so heavy until you need to be spotted like you do when you go to the gym. The trainer. I worked out with a trainer once. And so we were lifting the weight. And he would come behind me and push it up because it was too heavy. And some issues are just too much for you to try to even do it in your own strength. But the Holy Spirit comes and he spots you. He comes and he spots you. If you let him. If you let him. If you let him. So you got to let God spot you. And here's the good deal. Even if you just desire to do it, but you say, I just can't bring myself to do it, you're in a good place. You're in a good place. You know why? Because the work is almost done. Let me give you a scripture. Philippians 2:13. It says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. It is God who works in you. God gives you the desire and he gives you the power to do it. It is God who works in you both to will and to do. That's good stuff. It is God who works in you both to will and to do. And you began to personalize that scripture. I've said that 2 or 3 times now, how you personalize the scriptures and make them your own. I said, God, I thank you that you are working in me to will. It is my will to do this. I can't do it in my own strength, but I thank you that you are working in me. You're giving me a desire to want to do it. And he doesn't do half job. When God begins a good work, he completes it. Amen? Well, let's look at decision number 2. Leaving payback to God. Leave payback, revenge, retaliation. Whatever you want to call it. Retaliation means to return the punishment. That's what retaliation is. You don't have to return the punishment because only God has the authority to avenge a wrong. Only God has the right to do that. You can't justify that. You can't justify that. Only God has the right to do that. And we do it all the time. We do it all the time, even on the freeways. How many of you are on the freeway sometimes and somebody cuts in front of you and you honk at them? That's an action of protest. I'm getting you back. Shouldn't have done that. But I got strategy now for the freeway because they freeways that keep you in bondage. All these bad drivers out here, you'll be mad all day. You won't have any peace of mind. By the time you get home, you're ready to cuss folks out. So I got 2 strategies now. Okay, the first strategy is when I mess up. All right, I'm driving on the freeway and I accidentally cut somebody off. Because I'm perfect. So I accidentally cut somebody off. And then here's the thing. When they get beside me, I act like I'm a little old lady. And I start driving like this. Like I'm so confused and lost. That's so they don't shoot me. But when they cut in front of me, I say, that's a prayer request. So I start praying for the person. I do. I say, God, I want to thank you for that person. I want you to bless this family. You put them in front of me like that so I can pray for them. And so I do. I actually pray for people like that. And it keeps me really, really peaceful on the freeway. Well, the other day, somebody was on my bumper. I mean, he was on my bumper. That's really my pet peeve. Like, don't drive so close to me. So I usually would start tapping my brakes. That wasn't working for this one. So I said, wait a minute. That's right. Let me find a way to turn this to the glory of God. So this is what I did. I said, this person's trying to get closer to God. I said, the spirit in me is drawing him closer. Come on in. See, I kept my peace. You got to be intentional in keeping your peace. You got to be intentional. Listen, there's a story in Genesis 50. It's in throughout Genesis, Genesis 37 through 50. But it's the story of Joseph and how we know the story, how his brothers sold him into slavery and he had to be in prison in Egypt. And he suffered a lot because of somebody else's doing. But he finally revealed himself to them when a famine came. They came and he was able to make sure everybody had food. But here's the part I want to get to. When they came to him and their father had died, and they said, listen, Joseph, we know we were awful to you. But daddy said to forgive us before he died, and we know you're probably going to get us back. And that he said, listen, fear not. That's in Genesis 50 and 19. He said, fear not, for am I in the place of God. Don't be scared. Don't even think I'm going to retaliate. I don't take God's place. Don't you be scared. Fear not, for am I in the place of God. And this is what he said. But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. God meant it for good. Come on, say that. God meant it for good. You got to tell yourself that. I don't care what's going down in your life. All things are working together for your good because you love God. No matter what the enemy tries to do, you say God meant it for good. Because here's the deal. Nobody can thwart God's purpose for your life. All things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. So this is what Joseph said. God meant it for good in order to bring about, as it is this day, to save many people. You know, while you meant it for bad, God was positioning me so that I could be the savior of this known part of the world. I think we ought to give God a hand clap for that. Amen. But you see, you got to have a good attitude to do that. You got to have a divine perspective to do something like that. Now, see, I have a little friend here. He's been patiently waiting. And my little friend here is often used to destroy people's peace. Now, he looks pretty real, doesn't he? When I do this, he looks real. And but this little booger is mean. See, he'll talk about you, lie on you. And if you don't watch yourself, you get caught up in the puppet. Well, what's motivating the puppet? Me. You see, there are people in your life who have been puppets of the devil, and you're so busy being mad at the puppet, you forget to declare war on the devil. Listen, folks, this is not, we don't fight with flesh and blood. We need to learn how to declare war on the devil. If you want to stop the puppet, stop the hand that's moving the puppet. That's why we got to pray for those who have hurt us, because we got to take them out of the hand of the enemy. We got to take them out of the hand of the enemy. We got to take them out of the hand of the enemy. Because let me tell you something. I want to just share this with you. Forgiveness is good for you. I am so at peace today. If forgiveness is so good for you, and I just started to recount all the times when I had things that I didn't want to forgive. Even financially, it's good for you. I had this guy who called our office once, and he said, I want to send a book to a friend, and I want your 30 Days to Tame Your Tongue book, because she really needs that book. And he told me all this private stuff. He said, but I want you to send it anonymously, because I don't want her to know that I send it to her. So just send it to her and just say a friend. And he told me all the personal stuff. And he said, I'll send you the money later. He never sent the money. I was so mad at him. I kept that invoice for 3 years. And the Lord said, put that invoice up. It was under $20. I'm like, it's the principal of the thing. He owes me. He's supposed to pay his debt. And you know what? I couldn't even be creative enough to do what I needed to do. Every time I went through that unpaid bill file, there was that little debt. I said, that scoundrel, that dirty dog, he needs to pay me my money. Well, you know what? Finally, when I released that, I just felt like my creativity just took off. Honestly, I just threw it out. My husband had been saying, throw that thing away. I'm like, nope, it's the principle of the thing. Listen, you can hide behind principle all day and stay in bondage. But when you are upset with somebody, they control your thoughts. Oh, yeah, they decide what you're going to think about. You're thinking about them. So I am not ready to give that kind of power to anybody else in my life. Are you? Are you ready to give that kind of power to somebody? No, you're not. I want to wrap it up here. But forgiveness is good for you. It's good for you emotionally because you're not letting people rent free space in your head. And there are some of you this morning will say, listen, you know what? I don't have a grudge against anybody. I just have a hard time forgiving myself. Anybody like that this morning? Who is it? Let me see. Who is that needs to need to forgive themselves. All right, we're going to be praying for you in a few minutes. Need to forgive yourself. Because the enemy's number one tools is guilt. He will make you feel so bad, and you don't have to. You don't have to. Let me read you a scripture. Isaiah 43:25. You don't have to feel bad. This is what the Bible says. God says, I am he who blots out your transgressions. I love that. Just imagine a big ink spot right over what you just did. I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remember your sins no more. See, that's real, people. If you've asked God to forgive you, he has forgotten about it. See, only God does that. You don't have a sea of forgetfulness to throw your stuff into. Only God can do that. And because we can remember, we just have a hard time comprehending that God actually forgets. He can do that. He's God. He says, I forgot. What are you talking about? You come back the next day and say, God, I'm so sorry again. I just want to repent again. God's like, what? What are you talking about? I forgot that. That's done. That's under the blood. It's gone. Come on, say it's gone. So it's time for us to free ourselves from guilt, from the burden of guilt. It is time to free yourself from the burden of guilt. Listen, and the extent to which you can forgive yourself, watch how you forgive other people. If you got to have a whole cooling off period, you can't come back to God for a long time. That's how you make other people act. You got to have a cooling off period. No, you can't talk to me for a long time. That's not God. Scripture number 2, and I'm almost done. Hebrews 10:18. And when sin has been forgiven, I love this. When the sin has been forgiven, there's no need to offer any more sacrifice. When the sin has been forgiven, you don't have to keep offering sacrifices. You don't have to keep trying to make up for it. And let me tell you something. If there's somebody in your life and you see that they're trying to make up for what they did, you don't need to keep making them having to offer sacrifices. You need to say, you are released. You are free to go. All right? Because when the sin has been forgiven, no more sacrifices required. Listen, Judas killed himself because he could not handle the fact that he had betrayed Jesus. So he killed himself. Peter didn't kill himself. Peter denied him, saying, I don't know no so-and-so Jesus. Cursed. Peter was anointed, and he wrote some of the New Testament as well. I think God is awesome this morning. And I want to pray for those of you who may have been stuck in unforgiveness, whether it's against somebody else or whether or not you can't forgive yourself. I know God wants to do something very special in here this morning, because when I was praying about this message, and even this morning when I went out to walk for like two or three minutes, okay, it's about a 5-minute walk. But while I was out there walking, I heard one word in my spirit, and he said, Independence Day. It's time for us to declare our independence. We're not going to be controlled by the enemy anymore. We're not going to be controlled by unforgiveness. You know, one of the saddest stories in history is found in the story of the when the slaves were set free, and Abraham Lincoln set the slaves free. He made the decree so that it was effective January 1st, 1863. And guess what? The slaves in Texas didn't find out about it until June 19th, 1865. Over 2.5 years later, they celebrate that day. Now it's called Juneteenth. It's a black holiday. But that's because they celebrate the fact that the slaves got the news that they were free. Listen, you don't have to be delayed in understanding that over 2,000 years ago, Jesus set us all free, and we're free right now. I'm telling you right now. Here's the news. We have been freed, all right? We are free. We are free. Jesus has paid it all. The work has been done. And if you're here today and you know that you are stuck in unforgiveness, I want you to stand up. I want you to stand up. Come on, don't be shy. Don't look around you. They stuck too, all right? Just come on, just stand up. I just really want to do this, and I'm going to ask you to do something very bold, and nobody looking around, but I want you who are stuck, I just want you to see if I can get you to the altar now. I got a couple of minutes, and I just want to see if you can just come down. Those of you who are stuck, because I believe God just wants me to lay hands on a few of you, and I want you to just come believing that you are free. As you are moving from your seat, that's an act of faith, that you are moving from that place of unforgiveness, and you are moving to a place where you can release everybody. You can release everybody. You can release everybody. This is good for you. You're moving, even in your movement to this, in this direction. It's an indication that you're ready to release everybody. In the name of Jesus. I wanted you to get that person's name in your mind and get ready to leave it at this altar. You will not take it back, and you will not keep talking about it. You don't need to rehearse the wrongs. Rehearse means keep rehearing it. That's a form of retaliation when you're constantly reminding other people of what somebody did. That's how you kind of pay them back a little bit. You kind of ruin their reputation with somebody. That'll teach them. You don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. But I sense right now all over this auditorium that people are being released in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Come on, just get that person in mind. In the name of Jesus. Somebody stand behind her. In the name of Jesus, I release this. I release it. I release. Come on, say, I release everybody.
I release.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I release everybody. I release everybody. And release everybody. Father God, I pray for every person who has come to this altar today. Thank you for your word. Thank you that you're drawing us into your will. I thank you, God, that you're working in us to will and to do of your good pleasure. I release the power of the Holy Spirit right now. We break this a strong attachment to unforgiveness. We break it now. We break the spirit of unforgiveness right now. In the name of Jesus, we break it. We understand, God, that everything working together for our good. And what Satan meant for bad, you have turned it to good. You said in your word that many are the afflictions, the troubles and trials of the righteous, but you deliver us out of them all. Thank you for your word, God. We thank you for your word today. We thank you that you're delivering us out of them all. Father, you said that it's been good for us that we've been troubled, that we might learn your statutes. God, show us the gem that was in the abuse, the pain, the disadvantage. God, whatever happened to us that caused us to hold on to something, we release that. We cast down every imagination, every thought of revenge, every thought of retaliation. We leave it here. So whether it's financial or emotional or physical, whatever the pain was, we cast it at your feet today. In the name of Jesus. Come on, raise your hands before the Lord. Say, Father, I surrender. I surrender my unforgiveness. And I receive your love. I receive your power. And by the grace of God, I release everybody. Everybody. Say that person's name. Say, Father, I release, and say the name. Say the name. Say the name. Come on, say the name. You're out. It's done. You don't need that person's name on your lips ever again to talk about this issue, not in a negative way. In the name of Jesus. Come on, let's begin to praise God now for what he's doing in your life. Come on, praise him. Praise him. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We release everybody. We release everybody. Come on, go back to your seat. Tell two or three people as you go back, I release everybody. I release, tell them, tell your neighbor as you walk back. So I'm releasing everybody. Come on. I'm releasing everybody. I'm releasing everybody. Everybody. If you have anything against anybody, forgive them. That your Father in heaven may forgive you. Some of you are free today. You are free. You are free. This is your day of emancipation from the spirit of unforgiveness. We thank you. We thank you, Lord. I thank you for every soul that has come down. Now, right now, those of you with all the promises that I put on the screen today and those that we talked about, those are for God's children, those who have decided that he's going to be their Lord and their Savior. And if that's not you today, I want you to come down here. If you have never accepted Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, I want you to get down to this altar. We're not playing anymore. This is spiritual warfare. And you're going to need power to forgive. You're going to need power to be forgiven. And God's going to give you that because it's free. Forgiveness is free. If you're in the house today, nobody looking around, everybody who's saved, began to intercede for those who are still trying to make that decision. You don't have to be embarrassed. We'll be down here and hug you and hold on to you and help guide you through this process. It's easy. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that Christ rose from the dead, you shall be saved. We're going to give you space now to make that decision. Come on, if you're sitting next to somebody and you don't know for sure that person is saved or you may not know them, you can just say, do I need to escort you down front? It's all right. In the name of Jesus, I know this many people in the house at 11 o'clock service, somebody has not accepted the Lord as your Savior. Don't be stubborn. Don't think about being embarrassed. Just come on down in the name of Jesus. That's it. That's it. That's it. Come on down. God wants to do something special for you today. God wants to do something special for you today. In the name of Jesus, come on, come on. Everybody interceding. Don't be looking around. Intercede that God would touch the hearts right now. God is touching hearts right now in the name of Jesus. God is touching hearts. Come on, come on. Everybody look around. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We just thank you. Smart decision. Best decision you'll ever make. Best decision you'll ever make. We just thank God for salvation. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we know there are more, and God, many people want to be private, but you said to come boldly before your throne. God, I just pray for boldness right now. I pray that those who are on the fence, some are thinking, I don't want to be a hypocrite, so I want to wait until I get my act together. I want to wait until I stop doing this or that. Listen, God is here to help you. The Bible says Jesus is faithful to forgive us for our sins. You know what that means? If he's faithful, that means he knows he's got to do it all the time. And so you just come on down, because God's going to help you to stand. He'll forgive you every time you ask him. He will forgive you every time you ask him. So, Father, we thank you right now for these people who have come forth. We thank you that you love them so much. You would not let them stay the same. We bless you and we thank you for the best decision they'll ever make in their lives. Now I want you to repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and that you rose again. I ask you to come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. Make me a new creature. In the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, that by your power, I will serve you. I will read my Bible. I will pray, and I will join with other believers to walk this Christian walk. Thank you for drawing me in today, because you love me, and I love you back. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Go with the gentleman here. He's going to give you some more information. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand for his word today.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.